Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. There's a popular quote saying, waste is not a waste until it's wasted. This quote is perfectly in line with water resource, which is one of the limited resource in the world. As engineers in society, we always encourage conservation technologies. Even today, we are going to witness a wonderful lecture about wastewater management by one of the few specialists in this sector. Engineer Danesh Gunatilaka, who is the resource person today, is a proud product of University of Moratuwa. He began his career with a National Water Supply and Drainage Board in 1993. From 2008 to 2017, he worked as a design specialist for sewerage systems. And currently, he is one of the DGM of National Water Supply and Drainage Board. In addition, he holds a MSc for Sanitary Engineering. He is a chartered engineer and fellow member of ISF. Further, he is an international professional engineer. In addition, he holds a member of, he is a member of Chartered Institution of Water and Environment Management, UK. Without taking much time, let's warmly welcome our resource person of the day, and please put your hands together for Engineer Danesh Gunatilaka.
Thank you, Dilan, for the kind introduction. Hi, everyone. So today's topic is future trends in wastewater treatment and reuse. So my presentation outline will be on-site wastewater treatment and septage management, then wastewater treatment and reuse, and sludge treatment and reuse. So I will be concentrating more or less on this area because otherwise it will be not enough time. So first, why wastewater treatment necessary? That is to minimize the potential impacts of wastewater discharges, then favor the production of valuable end products, such as you can see reusable water, because unlike rain water, generally for agriculture or irrigation, we are relying on rain water. So it is we have to rely on the nature, but whereas when we do treat wastewater, generally throughout the day, throughout every day, we are generating more or less, depending on the plant capacity, we have a definite amount of water. So that is reusable water. And then nutrients, because wastewater, generally sewage, contain nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus. Nitrogen is mainly from our urine, and phosphorus is from detergents and other food products. So at the end of the treatment, we are producing the excess bacteria, so that which we call biosolids. So these biosolids, either we can use it as an energy source, or we can use it as a soil conditioner. Then in case of anaerobic treatment, we can generate methane, right? Even though in Sri Lanka, most of the treatment plants, we don't go for conventional activated sludge treatment, but we are more or less concentrating on activated sludge extended aeration. Therefore, we don't generate much methane. Since our topic is wastewater treatment and reuse, it is very important that all these are the concept that we have developed at Water Board in 2009. All these things are self-explanatory, but we have to concern about hazardous wastewater. For example, if we are planning to reuse them for agriculture or or aquaculture or whatever reuse application. So therefore, hazardous waste, if it is present, we have to separate them in concentrated form in a separate plumbing system, and then we have to handle them as a hazardous waste, either deactivate it or some sort of pre-treatment before applying. You can see industrial wastewater, different wastewater characteristics are there. So we have to do appropriate industry specific pre-treatment to bring it to the domestic level. Because for example, tannery wastewater, it contains chromium, iron in steel manufacturing, iron and other waste are there. So therefore, the way characteristics of the wastewater in battery manufacturing, lead is there. So therefore, we have to do appropriate industry specific pre-treatment to bring it to the domestic level. So then even in hospitals, there are different wastewater, especially laboratory wastewater, dental wastewater, then x-ray processing. If x-ray is printing, then this is not common. So there are so many things like silane, which can, you know, PVC pipe become soft and it can be deformed like this. So then ethidium bromide, which is carcinogenic. So that sort of thing we have to handle separately, and different categories has to be managed differently. So let's move to the on-site treatment and how it works. Now you can see from this animation how the on-site treatment works. So we, if it is a residential house, either we can have a grease trap for kitchen waste. Otherwise, you can send all the domestic waste water to the septic tank. Then, because septic tank is a watertight structure, it is completely filled up to the top level. When you flush a toilet or when you wash your hands, that same amount of water will replace from the septic tank, because it is a watertight structure. When it is filled up to the top level, that will replace. So the water part will be managed by a soil absorption system. So most often what happens is this soil absorption system doesn't work if this groundwater table is almost up to the ground level. So that is what happened in most places. As per the septic tank code, the seasonal fluctuation should be at least 2.5 meters below the ground level. So most of the places where we live, this is not possible, because in the coastal belt of our country, almost groundwater table is very high. So therefore, what can we do? So in 2009 code identified this requirement. So this is the septic tank as per the SLS 745 part 2, and you can incorporate an anaerobic filter. So anaerobic filter treating the treated effluent, partially treated effluent of the septic tank, and it goes from bottom to top, and there are perforations. So along this media, the treated effluent goes from out from here. So then it is having attached growth sort of treatment. So we can meet the BOD, COD, suspended solids requirements very easily, even when you discharge to inland surface standards by combining septic tank with anaerobic filter. So under the global partnership output based project, that is called GPOB project, Water Board is implementing for low income areas, especially where high water table areas. The contractors are designing the septic tank and anaerobic filter in one unit. So therefore, we can save lot of cost. Now here you can see when you construct this together, this concrete wall will combine with this concrete wall. Therefore, you can save lot of cost. Either we can do precast or we can do in situ concreting. So for this residential apartments or the houses, generally occupancy is about 5, so we can actually do this type of treatment, and soakage pit also can be introduced, but during rainy season it will not function, but the pollution level will be very much low, because you can meet the BOD 30, TSS 50, COD less than 250 very easily from this anaerobic filters, and operation cost is, there is hardly any operation cost. Only cost is maybe when you are desludging once in 5 years or once a year, then there will be a cost for you. Other than that, it is natural treatment. So that's why it is user friendly. So for therefore on-site treatment, I think the future will be because in Sri Lanka, you know that the coverage is only 2.5%, 2.1% for public sewer system. Some research projects going on combining this anaerobic filter part with biochar and some other materials you can consider. And this is a on-site treatment system. It is probably the only of this nature. You can see it is a gravity sewer system which is not designed in any design principles. So you can see the slopes and all that. So it doesn't have any manholes after screen, and we have introduced hatch boxes there instead of manholes. When you want to do maintenance, we can do with the portable sewer cleaning equipment. And here you can see the structures are in different levels. Therefore, in order to ensure the flow evenly, you need to have a flow splitter. Otherwise, the other units will have more flow. So otherwise, you can't have it. So we have introduced a flow splitter there, like that. And you can see the anaerobic filters, how the, you can see this edges. So this plants will be supported on that. Any sludge will be deposited at the bottom. So this is the anaerobic filter perforated bottom. So you can pack the media on top of that to facilitate attached growth sort of treatment. And here you can see the wetland there. So we can have different sort of wetlands to have a septic tank anaerobic filter with further treatment if you want with a wetland. Generally we don't go for free water surface wetland because this can have a issue on mosquito breeding, because the water level is about 100 millimeter above the media level, whereas this one we can eliminate that issue, especially our tropical conditions. This is much better because we will be maintaining water level always below the media level. And these are the typical wetland plants that we used. And also you can see in the picture septic tank anaerobic filter and constructed wetland which is in designed for Ratmalana Tsunami Housing Scheme near the Arthika Madhyasthani. So you can see the effluent quality there. So it is maintained by National Water Supply and Drainage Board. And this is again wastewater reuse system in Jaffna University Female Hostel. The after anaerobic filter, we have incorporated the wetland having canals because it is front of the the hostel, and they are reusing that water after chlorination for a long time now, about 3-4 years. And what you can do, I mean, there is an inherent problem in the anaerobic filters, because when you have the septic tank anaerobic filter, the only issue is there is a slight odor in the anaerobically treated effluent. And also ammonia will not be converted to nitrate because we will not be providing any oxygen. So that therefore you, by any chance, so the nitrification part will not going to happen. And if the receiving water pH is higher, say 8.59, then ammonium will change from its ionized form to ammonia, and ammonia is toxic to the most of the aquatic life, like fish for instance. So therefore you can easily include a sprinkling filter, and if you can sprinkle the water evenly with a larger media like 75 millimeter, then you can have a aerobic attached sort of growth sort of treatment here. How you can get oxygen? It is from, there is a ventilated manhole over there, so this will take the air, and when you increase the exhaust pipe as higher as possible, then due to the ventilation effect, there will be natural air drift. So like in the trickling filters, if you look at trickling filters, you will see there are holes there. That is to how you get the trickling filter nitrification, because there will be natural air drift inside the trickling filter. So see, only other disadvantage is, now if you have the septic tank anaerobic filter, your effluent is always taking from the top, but here because you need to separate the suspended solids, so therefore you need to have a pit kind of thing, and treated effluent always goes about one to two meters below. So that is the advantage, disadvantage where you need probably need to pump the treated effluent. And also if you want to get rid of odor and a little bit of suspended solids, if you don't have space for wetland or any other treatment, you can incorporate a sand filter, pressure filter, and followed by a granular activated carbon filter to get rid of odor and any color. So therefore you can reuse it for, and afterwards even you can have a UV disinfection system or chlorination, and you can reuse it for domestic purpose, or I mean non-portable users. And also there are precast treatment systems like Jocoso, for instance, is available. It is also similar to the our septic tank anaerobic filter. Only change is that they have the plastic media instead of metal, and then they have the aerobic sort of treatment also. So then you can get rid of the ammonium as at least nitrate. If you don't enhance the denitrification, still you can convert it to and even for these units are available up to even 100 meter cube per day, precast, and very quite easy for you to install, very rapid, very easily you can install. And moving to septage management, so all this on-site treatment, most of the population in Sri Lanka rely on on-site treatment. So therefore these septic tanks has to be desludged once in 5 years or so on. So this sludge has to be managed properly without polluting the environment. So there are if you go through the literature, different literature, you can see BOD strength is changing rapidly. So in water board, what we use it BOD 1000 as design value, and then only we will be designing the treatment units. And for septage management, we can have screening systems depending on the Gallisaco hose. You can directly connect to the system, that is also possible, and we have different other systems. And this is in Manik Farm during for emergency sanitation, we have designed septage treatment plant. Previous to this one, we have also designed for tsunami resettlement housing schemes once in Batiklo, but this one and Vaunia, we have two pond systems, and Vaunia one is upgraded for the city, for the municipal council. And you can see the anaerobic pond, facultative pond, and finally we have three maturation ponds for the many farm, and this lead to the septage management in the country more or less. And you can see that subsequently we have built plant in Chilau, Putlam, Manar, Vaunia with this type of system. Here also you can see anaerobic pond followed by facultative pond and also wetland combined with the wetland. And nowadays we have a big issue, because if you want to construct a pond system you need large land area, and we don't have the luxury of finding lands as we want for pond systems in some areas. So therefore what we do is now Talavakkale, under the WASIP project, World Bank funded project, we are designing anaerobic pond followed by extended aeration, that is mechanized. So only sludge recirculation is introduced and waste sludges can be pumped to a drying bed. So the very first of this type is now in about 1 or 2 years you can see them in operation. And the treated wastewater will be reused for the adjacent solid waste, the composting plant. The goals of under wastewater treatment, goals of biological wastewater treatment, now you can see suspended solids are fairly large particles compared to dissolved matter. Dissolved matter is very small, and then colloidal matter. So the particles are under biological treatment, all these substances are adsorbed by the bacteria in our sludge basically. So the matter is organic, biodegradable, example glucose, acetate sort of things. Then there are organics unbiodegradable like cellulose and lignin, very bit difficult to degrade by the bacteria. And inorganic, we have the biodegradable like nitrogen, sulfur and sulfur compounds, unbiodegradable like sand and silt. So what is bacteria? So morphology of bacteria is like this, and there are bacteria predators. So rather than I will show you some video clips of bacteria. So this is bacteria.
Bacteria often have round or rod shaped cells. Their diameter is not more than about 1/1000th of a millimeter, and they can only be observed with a microscope. Some species can move around.
So that is bacteria, and in our sludge we have protozoa and metazoa, the predators of bacteria. They also
it can indeed be observed that larger organisms move around between the flocks. These are protozoa, which eat mainly bacterial cells. Some protozoa crawl over the surfaces of the flocks and graze them. This one uses his legs to crawl over the surface of the flocks. Other species swim in the water between the flocks. This one is known as paramecium. The star shape is a cavity in the cell which is sometimes pumped empty and then sucked full again. This is actually a feeding method. Some species are coloured, such as this pale pink example. There are also protozoa which attach themselves to the flock by means of a stem. The water is forced to flow towards the mouth with the assistance of tiny hairs known as cilia. There, food particles, like bacterial cells, are taken up by filtration from the water.
So, when bacteria cells are isolated, they don't have much chance of survival than when they are attached to a flock because of that. And also there are metazoa like this one.
The multicellular metazoa are usually larger than protozoa. Nematodes are easily recognizable on account of their elongated and flexible bodies. Their method of propulsion and their branched tails are extremely characteristic of rotifers. Tardigrades, also known as water bears, have sorts of claws by which they grasp flocks. If this grip is absent, they move quite helplessly through the water. Worms, such as these oligocata, are gigantic in comparison with the other metazoa and the protozoa.
So in our activator sludge, 95% or more of the population is bacteria. So actually they are the one who is doing this sort of treatment. But when these predators are present, very little predators like rotifers are present, then we say it is a healthy flock or sludge. So they should be present as well. So microbial growth kinetics, it is very simple. So this organic matter, I have taken example as glucose. So in oxidation of organic matter, that is represented by the BOD, biochemical oxygen demand. So by heterotrophic bacteria, it is converted as bacteria. So this is represents the bacteria as an equation. So you will see that carbon dioxide and water will be there. So new bacteria cells will be formed. So and it will need about 1 to 1.2 gram oxygen per gram of BOD. So that in process design we will be calculating, but this is a general norm, about 1 to 1.2 gram oxygen is needed by bacteria. And nitrogen, as you know, nitrogen contains ammonia nitrogen, nitrate nitrogen and nitrite nitrogen, and organic nitrogen representing the biomass or the bacteria. So nitrification is basically conversion of ammonium initially to nitrite by a organism group, and then nitrate ultimately. And pH is very important for this activity. If pH is higher, this activity can drop, I mean will not function very effectively. So nitrification, there are two steps. First is conversion to nitrite, and it will require about 3.43 gram oxygen per gram of ammonium. And step 2, nitrite to nitrate, will require 1.14 gram oxygen per gram of nitrite. So altogether it's about 4.6 gram oxygen required for 1 gram of ammonium. So that is why in most people say nitrification is an oxygen hungry process. When you compare with organic matter oxidation, it is just 1 to 1.2 compared to 4.6. So nitrification, you need lot of oxygen. And denitrification is converting nitrate to nitrogen gas. You need specialized conditions like anoxic conditions, then the heterotrophic bacteria will convert. When they don't have oxygen, then they will shift to oxygen in the nitrate, and nitrogen bubbles out in the treatment process. So to check this, we need oxygen reduction potential. There are meters. In Sri Lanka we don't have it right now, but in Candy Sewerage you will see in another about 1 year, you will see ORP meters. Most places we don't use mechanized aeration, especially close to residential areas, because there could be bioaerosols depending on the wind condition, it can travel. Instead of that, we can go for fine bubble aeration like Soysapura, Jayalekala, even Candy Sewerage, then Kurunagala. We are using fine bubble aeration and it doesn't produce any aerosols. And you can see the here in the picture, the diffusers, and when the water is filled up, and you can see the oxygen sensor over there. So we can monitor the oxygen level online, and in future most of the plants we will need that sort of online equipment. And also you can check the mixed liquor suspended solids in the aeration tank online, like this one. And also pH, which is very important, because if the pH goes higher, then nitrification will stop. And also variable speed drives, you can see that this VFD drive, this is controlling the pump flow rate. In Soysapura, this one pump can operate with the VSD from 50 meter cube power to 1350 meter cube power at highest efficiency. So you can save a lot of energy, but you need to invest a little bit of money in front for the VSD drive, but you can save a lot of energy at the end. An NWSDB strategy for biological wastewater treatment is, most of the places, first thing we do, we consider natural treatment. If land is available, we go for natural treatment. Now, for example, this is Hikkaduwa, and also in Jaffna city, we have planned waste stabilization pond system, Hammanthotta, again, because waste stabilization ponds are very much beneficial, because in case of reuse, it is very good, because we can remove the helminthex and other parasites very effectively from pond systems. And also it doesn't remove lot of nutrients, therefore we can take a lot of nutrients in our system. And next one, if we have moderately land available, we go for aerated lagoon systems. I will show you later on. This is a recently upgraded Katharagama wastewater treatment plant, and we have new technology we have adopted, like in the water treatment plants, we have in the maturation pond, we have deepened area for biomass separation. Otherwise, your entire maturation pond, the bacteria flocks will settle down, and it will be expensive operation for the O&M staff. Therefore, we have upgraded, and this is for when you don't have much land, especially in Moratuwa, Jayawardhanapura area, we go for fine bubble aeration, activator sludge, extended aeration. Depending on where you want to discharge your treated effluent, we have to consider for biological nutrient removal or just extended aeration. Because if, for example, this is the treatment system for the proposed for Sri Jayawardhanapura Kotte, where we are planning to discharge to Devannawa in the seaplane bay area. Therefore, in order to minimize the eutrophication in the lake, we have to go for very high stringent standards, like BOD 10 milligram per liter, like that. Very high, and also total phosphorus less than 1, even though our inland surface standards are very relaxed compared to that one. We have set our own high standards depending on the location. If it is a sensitive area, then we have to go for further treatment. What we propose is a step feed biological nutrient removal. If time permits, I will explain later on. So the waste stabilization ponds generally comprises three types of pond systems: anaerobic, facultative and maturation. So the advantages are, you can see hardly any energy, simple operation, process entirely natural, no failures or breakdown in the mechanical equipment, because it is a natural treatment. And excellent choice for effluent reuse, can produce biodiesel, because in pond system lot of algae developed in the facultative ponds, and that can be used as a to produce biodiesel or biomass for energy generation, and also reduces carbon dioxide emissions, so greenhouse gases are reduced. Compared to in aerobic processes, we produce carbon dioxide. Then disadvantages are mainly large land area is needed. That is the only main disadvantage. So we can have pond system like this, anaerobic pond, facultative pond, but if there are residential areas, because anaerobic treatment, we generate methane, hydrogen sulfide, ammonia, so a lot of odor is produced. Therefore, we can, instead of that, we can go for two facultative ponds in series, and to get rid of bacteria, we can go for maturation ponds naturally without chlorination or any other means. So therefore, it is very good for the reuse application. So hydraulic profile of that similar systems, generally we have to have several anaerobic pond, at least two, because you need to de-slug them maybe after five years of operation. So therefore, the other treatment unit can should be able to take up the entire flow in such situations. But of course, facultative pond, you can design two treatment trains or one unit, because it doesn't need much maintenance compared to anaerobic ponds. So facultative ponds actually in the presence of sunlight generate oxygen. The algae take up carbon dioxide and generate oxygen, and that oxygen will be utilized by the bacteria for natural degradation of organic matter. So this is Hikkaduwa pond system, which is in operation since 2005. All these birds are there to catch fish, because the project director at that time, when you during commissioning, first you need to fill up with water, so the nearby river water is being used, and therefore you can see a lot of big fish is there in the pond system, even though we don't allow people to take fish there. And also we did a research with University of Moratuwa to incorporating water hyacinth to reduce the algae flowing along the river. I mean, after the maturation pond, part of the maturation pond, after facultative pond, one third of the area was enclosed with Iconia or Japanja burra to reduce the algae, because algae need sunlight. So if you have water hyacinth, you can prevent algae from flowing along with the effluent. And this is algae powered vehicles, so you can generate biodiesel and generate operate cars. So these are typical algae species. Nowadays people, even producers, biscuits having some algae, which is having high nutritious value, and also it can absorb, I think, heavy metals and other unwanted things from our body. So you can see the energy values. It is almost like this is biodiesel from micro algae oil, diesel fuel. Compared to that, you can see the heating values almost close to that. So the maturation ponds, this is actually the maturation pond for the defense headquarters. The plant is ready, we are waiting for the flow. So you can see the picture of the maturation pond at Akuregoda defense headquarters to get rid of the mainly bacteria naturally, right? Because it goes to the Devan now. And this is aerated lagoon I talked to you about in upgraded treatment plant in Kataragama. So the pre-treatment unit and the aerated lagoons, dissolved oxygen sensors, online monitoring is there. And this is the deepened area. You can see sludge pockets are there. So when the water fills up, the bacteria flocks can be contained here. So this is the maturation pond. This is the deepened area. So when land is moderately available, we can go for this So in conventional activated sludge, we had need to have a primary sedimentation tank. If primary sedimentation tank is there, we need to have a digester. So in our water wastewater treatment plants in Sri Lanka, we don't have this part because then it is again capital intensive and also suitable for high strength wastewater, because primary sedimentation tank removes 1/3 of the BOD and 2/3 of the TSS. So what we have is extended aeration. So these are the bacteria flocks. If you have this sort of microscopic image, that represent that filamentous bacteria, and it is indication of the plant is not being properly maintained. And if you have a flock like this, it is a healthy flock. As I showed you earlier, you can see the rotifers and other species are there, very little species are there. So that is an indication of healthy sludge. And nutrients are required, micro and macronutrients. And generally biodegradable CO2 to nitrogen to phosphorus is generally 100:5:1 for suitable for biological treatment. And extended aeration plants like oxidation ditches are available. So we don't have any primary sedimentation in front. And this is the type of aeration. And nowadays we go for this diffused aeration with propeller. And you can see some pictures in Kandy City. You will see the propeller is there to give the movement for the water, and oxygen is from fine bubble aeration. So advantage of this system is that in any other oxidation system, if you stop the aerator, the wastewater will settle. But here you have the luxury of the propeller will operate, and you have the water circulation. You can switch off the oxygen as and when needed to facilitate denitrification, or anoxic condition or anaerobic condition, if you want to do that with time operation, or you can design it designated area for denitrification and phosphorus removal. In phosphorus removal under anaerobic condition, acetate will take up, and first the bacteria will release its phosphorus to the water, and when they move to the aerobic system, they will take up more phosphorus than they have released. So this is how, and even oxidation ditch systems you can modify to have phosphorus removal and denitrification also. So this is A2O process, where you have the anaerobic, anoxic, aerobic, conventional A2O process for biological phosphorus and nitrogen removal. What we have in Soysapura is reverse A2O process, where you have 60% flow to the anoxic tank and 40% of the flow to the anaerobic tank. So you can see the pipes are in this one. You can see for the anaerobic pond, the 40% of the flow comes here, because they need acetate, readily biodegradable organic matter. So this pipeline will stop exactly at that compartment. So the flow splitting arrangement is there to facilitate after anoxic to anaerobic. Because of the organic loading, it will go anaerobic, and also denitrifying bacteria will be always satisfied, because denitrification is already taken place. So therefore they don't compete for the food in the anaerobic tank. And we need, of course, mixers, because otherwise wastewater will settle down. Even though we don't have, here you can see in the aeration compartment diffusers in there, but here we don't have any diffusers, only mixers, just to keep the sewage in suspension. So this is what we plan for Javadarapura Kotte. You can see the treatment plant there, and there are so most of the compartments, all the odor producing parts are inside the buildings to ensure odor free environment around the treatment plant. And the treatment process includes step feeding. So we have anaerobic, anoxic, aerobic, again because we have three flow splitting like this. Again, for the last one, we have another anaerobic anoxic. Anaerobic is to phosphorus release, and the finally the phosphorus will be taken in the aerobic treatment. So therefore, we can go for very high phosphorus removal. And you can see the sedimentation tank to separate the bacteria and the water. So you get the treated effluent with UV radiation and discharging to the DA1OO, we have the chance of reusing. So this is the drainage plan for Javadharapura Kotte as per the SLLRDC drainage plan. So there will be road network, this can be used by the people, and this is only the treatment plant area. And this is the under construction Kandy City wastewater project. You can see four oxidation ditch systems and four sedimentation tank and all other units under construction. And this is recently commissioned Kurunagala wastewater project. You can also use sequential batch reactors, even though it is not being used here very much, especially for when you have less land, you can go for sequential batch reactors where you have the aeration, filling, aeration, sedimentation, decanting processes in one unit. But you need the equalization tank to because it is operate on batch process. And then we can go for membrane treatment. If you want to go for a high level of reuse standards, the membranes can be immersed in the aeration tank to separate the bacteria basically and the clear water. Then we can have a membrane moving bed bioreactors where you have the attached growth and the suspended growth together. That is by introducing plastic media where you have the you can have the biofilm like this one on the plastic media. So you have the attached growth and the suspended growth in the same reactor, therefore you can reduce the footprint of the plant. So these are the media, and also we can introduce upflow anaerobic sludge blanket with downflow hanging sponge. There is a sponge material you can introduce where you can inside the sponge you can have very high concentration of bacteria. So therefore you can have a very small footprint of the plant. Especially trickling filters can be upgraded with vertical hanging sponge like this one. You can see the bacteria can be, you know, included inside the so different type of sponge material is available. So design parameters can be collected, and I think in future you might encounter them. And reuse of wastewater. Now you can see I don't know whether you can see any water there. This is a river actually in India, Jalgaon, but they are doing more agriculture than us. The annual precipitation is about 300 millimeter per year, and we can use treated wastewater to replenish water bodies or canals like this one. So we can use different purposes treated wastewater. So important parameters are fecal coliform and indicator organisms, and chemical parameters like these generally used for agriculture purpose. High risk are the helminth, that is why in pond systems we can remove this helminth like Ascaris, very severe parasites, very difficult to kill them, but in pond system we can very easily remove them. And medium risk enteric bacteria and low risk and so on are there. And you can see from this one, pathogen survival on soil and crop in warm climates. Here you can see on soil, you can see worm eggs like Ascaris. It can survive on soil for 180 days. So that is why there is high risk in it. So therefore we have to select proper technology for reuse application. And also lot of nitrogen and phosphorus available in treated wastewater, so it can be used as a plant nutrient. We can use different technologies for use for reuse application. But for example, if we are to use like tomato, for instance, where we eat them raw, we can't use sprinkler irrigation like that, because the contamination can occur, or we can we have to stop the application time has to be stopped before you have the harvesting, something like that. There should be like that. But micro irrigation and drip irrigation are good for that type of leafy vegetables and so on. And here also you can see the efficiency of irrigation. You can see drip irrigation is the highest, and like that, depending on the crop type, you have to select the technology. And we can use different barriers, like treatment and storage. Once you treat it, we have to have proper storage and avoid recontamination, and also harvesting measures, crop restriction, human exposure control, and application time of irrigation. From that we can have safe irrigation practices of treated wastewater reuse. And these are the trade-offs of economic value of water and nutrients against environmental and public health risks. So these are the risks, and these are the economic advantages of using the treated wastewater. And you can see unsafe practice in top pictures. You can see how the treated, or the, you can see sometimes a raw wastewater goes from to the agricultural land, and you can see salad leaves are grown on that, and that is unsafe. The same thing when you have the proper treatment, and you can see the drip irrigation system, the pipelines over there. So then, and also safe food washing will have the minimize the risk. So these are the in Tunisia some reuse applications, and Kuwait, and in Dubai also you can see. And these are the different technologies you can use. But for example, if you are going for sprinkler irrigation, drip irrigation, then we have to reduce the suspended solids, because otherwise you will clog your especially drip irrigation systems and so on. So depending on the application type, you have to select the level of treatment also. So this is Jaffna city. You can see the anaerobic ponds, two facultative ponds, two treatment drains in parallel, and three maturation ponds. And we'll be pumping the treated water more or less about 5 kilometers upstream for agriculture purpose. When the rainy season, we can directly discharge the lagoon, because we'll be meeting the inland surface standards. Therefore, we don't have any issue. We have obtained the EIA clearance for reuse application, the first project, major municipal wastewater project in Sri Lanka. And also we have obtained the EIA clearance for Hambantota city sewerage system. Again, it is conditioned for domestic wastewater only, to guarantee the safety of the reuse application. Rather than discharging to the salt plains, we have taken it inland, because it is a water stress city like Jaffna city. So this is actually not wastewater reuse, but in Jalgaon you can see when drip irrigation is used, you can see there is hardly any weed grown, right? Because we will be applying the water directly to the plant. So therefore you can see no weed growth there, and all the water will be taken up by the plant itself. And also you can feed the nutrients or the any other fertilizer with the water, depending on the plant growth stage. Whatever the things the plant want, depending on the soil condition, because soil itself will have some nutrients. So why we give the nutrients already available in the soil? So you can actually give depending on the plant stage, what is needed for the plant with the drip irrigation. So even in water board, we have we are giving treated wastewater from Jayala plant to a Hydramani washing plant at 25 rupees per cubic meter, compared to the commercial rate is 75%. So already we have the obtained the board approval, so we can give any industry if they want, they can check the water quality. And for the washing plant, of course, it is okay for them. So now for the past 2 months more or less, they will be using our water about 140 cubic meters per day with the Bowser supply at 25 rupees they are taking. And the sludge, finally, what can we do for the sludge? Here you can see either if we have a conventional activator sludge, then we need to have a digester, and then the that sludge and also extended aeration part will produce sludge. Then this sludge has to be managed properly. So we in sludge dewatering, we are removing the water in the sludge particles. Different water is there. Different technologies can be used, thickening, digestion, so many options are there, sun drying, mechanical dewatering application, and landfilling. Or we can go for mechanical dewatering, compost drying application, or we can go for like in Japan, they can go for incineration or sludge melting as well, and application landfilling. So this is bell filter presses. Generally, we in our old treatment plants, we have bell filter presses. In the treatment plants under construction right now, we have screw press dehydrators for candy. So after mechanical dewatering, we have the solar dryer to increase the dry solid content further to facilitate composting. So these are the solar dryer. And we are operating this one since 2011 at Jayala. You can see that. And the advantage of this is the energy input is 2 to 3 kilowatt hour per kilogram dry solid. Energy output, if you want to burn this one, it is not generally readily burning, but if you can have some preheating facility, then it will burn. And it has 11 megajoule per kilogram dry solid, lot of energy value. About 2/3 of wood is available. But here with the solar drying, we keep all possibilities open for reuse or disposal. So if you want to compost it, we have the that material very much suitable. Actually, 1/3 of that is being already used by a composting person right now. Here you can see the sludge is being used for composting. You can see other material there, and finally they produce us compost with 1/3 of that is being sewage sludge after solar drying. Solar drying is also helpful to deactivate the other parasites or other bacteria, because in the solar dryer during daytime the temperatures go beyond 40 degrees centigrade. So that is also very useful. And also we are not altering the properties of the sludge. And these are the European Union guidelines, and the Sri Lankan draft standard also prepared in line with this one. So these are the heavy metal limitation, limit value milligram available for kilogram of dry solids of sludge. For example, cadmium 10 milligram can be maximum value can be used. And this is per kilogram of phosphorus, how much milligram heavy metal can be. You can refer to this. This is the European Union guideline, and the Sri Lankan draft standard is also prepared in line with this one. And this is the limit value gram per hectare per year. This is when you are applied to a land, then you can't indefinitely apply it over and over there. The maximum that you can permit in a farmland is this much. This is gram per hectare per year. And also when you use sewage sludge in the cement factory, the NOx emissions, NO2, NO3 emissions can be controlled 40% just because of when you adding sewage sludge. And in Japan, they use phosphorus, especially from bell filter press. So mechanical dewatering, the liquid that generate from the bell filter press having high amount of phosphorus, so then they can prepare, they can produce pellets there, and phosphorus, and also biochar can be produced from sludge. And this is melting plant, but you need very high temperature, so definitely it is not an attractive methodology for Sri Lanka, at least in the present context. And also this is some other countries when they have the conventional sludge, conventional activated sludge, the digesters and other things are there, and you can use it when you have this molten slag, you can use construction material out of that sludge, because no heavy metal or anything will leach, because once you make with cement, it is not leaching back into the water environment. So you can use them, and also you can see even this is mass fabric park. You can see they also producing a lot of bricks for the mass chain. So they are making different cement blocks for their own facility. And digestion, of course, you need lot of infrastructure to generate biogas. But then also you need primary sedimentation as well. So this will be much beneficial when you have high strength domestic wastewater. So again, when you want to go for digestion, you need to have gas holding stand. Then emergency flaring. If you don't use the gas, you have to burn them. And also this is biogas stations are there, and also you need generators, right? So different options. And this is again USB, generally popular in some countries in like India, for instance. So this is again a brewery wastewater having upflow anaerobic sludge blanket. The advantage of this one is very good for the high strength wastewater, BOD more than 1000-2000, then you can reduce the BOD by 65%, and at the same time you can produce gas, and you can see the footprint of the plant is lesser because you have large column like structures like silos, for instance. So it is advantageous in that context, high strength. And also you can take different levels. What is the sludge type, condition, you can see the granules, granules in the sludge layer. And finally, to conclude my presentation, sometimes we don't know whether in future what will lead to us, because now you can see this is a urine diversion toilet. So maybe we discuss about advanced treatment, but sometimes when I think Mr. Dilip Gunawardhan asked me, now you are doing a presentation, have you included anything about eco-sanitation, right? Then I said no, but I have some picture just to say that this is like any person, when we are born we have urine and feces are separated. So therefore if you can separate the urine and you can direct it into a plant directly without any odor issues, so then you have the nutrients and you have all these complex things to because you need lot of water to flush in the sewer pipe. So that is, I don't know what will be there in the future for us. Even like in vacuum system, you can suck this one, and if you don't use lot of water, then this solid part will readily harden, and it can be used as a soil conditioner also, right? So finally all we do treat wastewater in order to protect our environment for future generation, and every drop is precious. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah, according to the SLS 745 part 2 2009 and part 1 2004, you need at least 1 meter water depth for solid separation, because septic tank is basically is a kind of a sedimentation tank, but the sludge will undergo digestion in addition to the suspended solids separation. Therefore, it is main function is sedimentation in the first, at least in the first compartment. So therefore, your question is quite true, and these are about 4 feet in diameter. So therefore, it is okay. But when you have very small cylinders, that will not facilitate it. So at least 1 meter depth, if you can have it, then you have better performance. We prefer to go for, in-situ cast systems. Like for example, Sripada, we have anaerobic filter and large tanks. But then when it comes to domestic level, it has to be easily installed. Weight of the structure should be less, and it should be able to be taken to the probably backside of the house. So depending on that, the final compromise is about 4 feet in diameter. If it is isolated from the network, you can go for this type of thing. Yeah. Huh? It is not mandatory under the law. In Seychelles, it is mandatory. I worked in Seychelles. There, when it is declared as sewered area, sewered network, you are mandatory to connect into the system. New projects, what we do is, because it is expensive to be connected to the sewer network. So that is why most of the residents doesn't like to connect, especially in the old systems. So what we do is, when we sought for the donor agency's financing, we make sure that the interceptor chamber, at least interceptor chamber, everything is included in the project cost. And nowadays we are thinking even connecting to the, because for the house owner, he has to modify his system to connect into the IC chamber also. That is also significant amount. Especially for low income people, it is very difficult. So therefore, we are thinking in shift project even to include that part into the project cost. For the housing buildings, important thing is whether you have having a flowing water body to discharge the treated effluent. If it is in the if it is within the network area, of course you can connect it. No, if the capacity of the sewer is there. Outside the urban area, most important thing I would see is to because when you are discharging the treated effluent to a water body, it should have 8 times dilution, at least 8 times dilution during the dry season. Otherwise, you will not be given permission to discharge, because our standards. Do you want me to explain why it is now suppose if we are to discharge to a water body, you can see from this animation the dissolved oxygen saturation is about 7.83. if this river is a sort of clean river, then the dissolved oxygen saturation in the river depends on the temperature. So at 28 degrees dissolved oxygen saturation is about 7.83. So therefore, our standard maximum BOD level is specified as 30 milligram per liter, and in the notes it is given 8 times dilution. So when this water goes to a receiving water body having 8 times dilution, this BOD 30 will be after dilution it will be 30 divided by 8, it is about 3.75. When you deduct this 7.83 from 3.75, there will be about 4 milligram per liter remaining. So after biological bacterial activity, this will be reduced. So then there will be still 4 milligram per liter available for the fish to survive. So that is how the standard has been set. But if you have the water body having lesser dilution, that means you can still go for higher level of treatment and meeting the requirement. Then you can justify it to the either environmental authority or so on with the level of treatment. I don't know whether I have answered the. So then, if it is not there, then you do not have any other choice other than reusing the water. Then, if you have enough land, then you can go for. Green areas, or you can go for toilet flushing and so on. I have some video clips of reusing wastewater in Australia, but it will take about 5-6 minutes. Otherwise, I can show you. So different application other than pools, then drinking water. Other than that. They produce class A recycled water, which is UV radiation is applied after treated effluent, and with addition to that they add chlorine to make to make sure that it is safe. Even and they have removable tap handles for the garden taps, so the children can't play around opening and taking that water. And they have proper signages, different color codes, different water meters there. Because in Melbourne area, there are some part of the year they have water restrictions. So unlike us, they don't have the luxury of having water. So they have second water also metered. But we need to when you have the reuse water, you have to have a different color code. Otherwise, and licensed plumbers has to be there to connect them properly. And you can use it for toilet flushing, or then you have to justify with a water balance for the approving authorities to recommend it. Then you have to show that crop water requirement is this much, you have land area for that one. So then you have to actually balance and show them. Otherwise, there will be an issue by discharging.
now, I saw even in Sri Lanka, they are selling these Rumpak pyramids. I do not know how they really operate, but they say it's all sealed and all anaerobic and you know, bacteria is within, and it's permanent, it will go on forever. I do not know whether it will work or not, but they say it is guaranteed to work a bit.
Because in anaerobic treatment, it generates very little sludge compared to aerobic treatment. But that doesn't mean that you can't operate it forever. Even septic tank, you have to, depending on your design, so there are empirical equations, you can calculate what is the volume required for settling, digestion and so on. Finally, then you can calculate the volume required, but then you have to decide the how often you are going to dispose the sludge. So in any treatment you can minimize the sludge generation, but one day you need to de-sludge definitely, because the reason is 20% of the bacteria, when they die, 20% of the bacteria is having inert material like lignin. So that will not be degraded by bacteria again. So that will accumulate in the septic tank. Septic tank or any treatment, once the bacteria, there are new bacteria formed as well as bacteria dying. So there will be inert material produced at the end of the day. So so maybe you can prolong the requirement, but one day you need to do that. Unless you go for directly from toilet to the garden, some arrangement, whether you remove the water and something like that.
I cannot remove the water. It is the Japanese system.
Yeah, that is Jokosa system that I showed you, probably the same one.
Sometimes. Embedded in the system.
Yeah.
So the
they have some enzymes, but end of the day, still, whatever it is, I don't think they can operate it without desludging. Only thing, you can prolong the time period, then you can enhance the digestion or the degradation process, but there will be something that very difficult to degrade part also. So maybe someday you need to desludge, definitely.
What is the cost of purified water for drinking purposes? Because actually water is a scarce resource, as you say. It is getting even much scarce, even in Sri Lanka now, they say 50. Maybe not now, maybe in another 50 years. You may be worse than perhaps Melbourne. Because it's a problem. Therefore, they say the new industry is to purify water. I mean, the new opportunities are for water purification, like solar, renewable. So, what cost will be involved for
water purification?
Yes, so purification for drinking purposes.
Actually, you first for the water treatment, you have to analyze your water source. Probable water source could be some gravity spring or something, or groundwater or surface water like a river. So then there is a quality fluctuation during rainy season and dry season. There is a large variation. So then based on the quality standards of the particular water source, you need to bring it to the drinking water standards. So then you have to have your treatment units aligned to meet this quality, raw water quality fluctuation to meet the drinking water standards. So then you can decide your unit process of the water treatment plant, like in the wastewater treatment plant, for example. Wastewater treatment plant also raw water quality and the treated effluent quality is necessary. Because depending on where you want to discharge, to the sea, to the reuse agriculture, or reuse for some other purpose. So like that, even in the water treatment, depending on the water source, quality fluctuation of the dry season and the wet season, then we have to figure out what is the treatment. Example is groundwater. So the groundwater can contain iron, manganese, fluoride. Arsenic is fortunately not available in Sri Lanka, but if you go to Bangladesh, arsenic is also a problem. So depending on the iron manganese level, because if iron is present, manganese is present, your clothes will stain when you wash, your toilet bowls will stain. So then you have to figure out what is the level of the iron and manganese. Likewise, the turbidity, color and other parameters. So and also if there are pesticides, heavy metals are there, if the industry is discharging upstream, then you have to consider that also. So then you have to decide what are the parameters to be removed and what is the variation of that in the water source. Then only you can, then iron and manganese is not a big issue in the river water, when you take up water from rivers. But if you are taking water from a lake, then the important thing is whether the lake has algae. If algae is present, then you have to go for DAF system or some other technique to remove algae. If you can add chlorine, but then algae will give algal toxins. When you have stress for the algae, they will produce algal toxin. If algal toxin is there, then at the end of the final treatment, you need to have activated carbon or something to get rid of the toxins. So like that, so many parameters to be considered based on the water quality of the particular source. If it is a lake, a different scenario. If it is a spring, or if it is groundwater, if it is a river water, now if you consider Kalani River or Kalugaga, then you get a high level of color and turbidity, large variation. So then coagulation, flocculation, sedimentation is the basic processes. And if you have a lake water, then you have to introduce aeration. Sometimes there are dissolved gases and other stuff in the lake water. So then aeration is a must. And then if there are algae and other thing, then you have to consider that. If that is not present seasonally, sometimes what is happening is when you design the plant, it is not there. But after 5-10 years in operation, then there will be some pollution, nutrients will be coming to the lake. So then your condition will different, and there will be algae blooms and other things will come at least during dry seasons. So then you may have to modify your the treatment process also. That is the it is not a exact answer. So you have to find out what is the water quality and its variation, seasonal variation, then you can decide the unique process. So generally in water board we have different production cost, because for example gravity schemes having high quality raw water, we can spend about 80 rupees per cubic meter for production, but some places it is more than 60 rupees. So average is about 42 rupees per cubic meter, but we are selling for the residents at initial 15 meter cubes. One unit is 1000 liters, so first 15 meter cube subsidized rate. So we will be selling at a loss actually, most of the because most of the treatment plants having full treatment, coagulation, flocculation, sedimentation, then filtration and chlorination.
Now, while ago you mentioned that the quality of water varies from calcium channel. Can be when but water source pumping from any trigger or lagoon and then you know, purifying this thing.
Labugam is a different treatment plant. Kalatuava different treatment plant. Yeah, Labugam Kalatuava, they have that is impounding reservoir. So then we have separate treatment plant. It is not connected with the Kalani River. So they have independent treatment and they have independent distribution networks. But then Can River independent, and we have two treatment plants, left bank and right bank. The Biyagama plant is on the right bank and the Ambatale is on the left bank.
But about the rain meadows, now somebody said that what about this monthly filtering and guaranteeing the rain meadows? Rain meadows can be present this day.
Some heavy metal may be removed in the coagulation, flocculation, finally ending up with sedimentation. But generally, according to the standards, we have the standards for the heavy metals. So at the moment, we don't have much issue in it, less than the minimum permissible level. Raw water, we are analyzing the raw water because we have the SLS for Abatale treatment plant. So we will be monitoring the heavy metal and so on.
Monitoring.
We are monitoring it. It is mandated to monitor, especially when you have the ISO standards and so on. But on the other hand, we have some concerns in the Biyagama export processing zone. At the moment, we are under implementation of the interceptor sewer to bring the treated effluent downstream of the Ambatale intake. It is included in the present contract at Biyagama phase 2. So it is there. So after that, there will not be much concerns. But there is a cabinet decision because these industrial zones were established long time back. So we can't do anything there. But in future projects, what we can do is if there is a drinking water intake upstream, if there are industry categories, type A, type B, and so on. Type B is more or less domestic nature wastewater. That doesn't have much problem. If it is type A industries, then it can produce some micropollutants. So therefore, we have the provision of, establishing such industries in the upstream of the drinking water intakes. There is a cabinet decision in 2009. So with that, we have even the Horana Horana fabric park was changed to type B industries because of that. Then we found that finally we managed it, and there were some cancer hospital trying to establish in private cancer hospital in Horana also. That was stopped because we have the industrial siting policy, and it will be considered at the environmental authority prior to giving approval to the industries. So with that we can safeguard. But the Sitavaka and Biyagama zones, they are already established. So we have to manage, we are monitoring it, especially during extreme dry conditions. We are monitoring very seriously.
Possible of what would produce water. Since the gathering is all engineers, I am asking this question. Today, of course, I know that even at the house level, the road supply and drainage road supply water is used only for washing and cooking, right? But not for drinking. Instead of that, this bottled water has come to the sea. So, would you like to?
There are
few words
about
that.
Yeah. I didn't honestly analyze the water quality to comment on it, but I think our water is much safer than probably most of the this bottled water, because nobody's regulating it properly, I think, but I am not expert to say about it, so I can't really comment, because and even the RO water, because it doesn't have quite minerals required for the our body, so those things very difficult for me to comment, because we are not analyzing the quality of the water in the market. If we are to comment, then we have to analyze them thoroughly. Sometimes during the approval stages, maybe like EPL stages in wastewater treatment plant, occasionally it is monitored, but throughout the day I don't know. But for example, in water board, we are analyzing the raw water quality daily. We have our own lab, because the raw water quality changes daily. Your suspended solids and color and the turbidity changes. So then we do the jar test, because the jar test is when the particles are we have very small collider particles which will not going to settle, because they have very small particles. Even my presentation I have shown you collider particles. So collider particles you can't settle unless you coagulate and flocculate. So when you flocculate, the negative charges is removed, then the particles will come together and form a flock. Then the flock has sufficient weight so that it can settle by itself. All these individual particles cannot settle. So therefore, what you can do is daily basis, now particles are changing. Therefore, the amount of alum and lime to be added has to be changed. So if the water source is, I don't know the exact water source for the most of the for bottled water industries to comment on it. So we have to analyze. Maybe Ministry of Health may be monitoring that. So it is not our mandate to monitor the. So without monitoring, I can't comment. So the safety, very difficult to comment on that. But most of the water authorities in the world, they are trying to establish and give the confidence to people to drink potable water. That is what even some I have visited in Korea, one water treatment plant, they are producing the bottled water, but they are trying their best to educate the people and to make drink their water, because everybody is trying to encourage people to drink water and to guarantee the water. Now not only that, out of the 333 water supply schemes in Sri Lanka under the water board, we have water safety plan established for about 70% of the water supply schemes right now. So we have the water safety plans established. So that will guarantee what are the risk, because when you are establishing a water safety plan, we have to monitor what are the risks there. If there are estate without having sanitation facilities, or if there is an industry, what is their water quality and how they treat it, and whether that have a negative impact on the water quality of the river. So those things will be monitored. And also if there are disasters, natural disasters, what can you do for your plant what are the protections, all these things, the each and because this water safety plan for different water supply scheme is completely different. So after establishing water safety plans, I think most of that schemes you can be confident about drinking that water. So only thing what we can do is, I think normal pollution is not a issue. Only in large industries having type A industries categories, if you locate them proper locations, so then nobody is needed to worry about.
I invite Engineer Dinesh to please remain in state because we are having small token of appreciation for him on behalf of ISL and the Building Services Engineering Sectional Committee. I cordially invite our Building Services Sectional Committee, our fellow member of our Executive Committee, Engineer Keerthi Senanayake, to present the token of appreciation. Engineer Dilan will assist. We'll give it. Thank you very much, Engineer Senanayake. So we really appreciate midst of his many commitments, he has shared a timely, valuable, very much important session with us regarding the water, the future trends in wastewater treatment and reuse. So as engineers working in this building services industry as well as in other water projects, this is going to be timely, valuable topic for us, and it is indeed in the context of the society is talking about sustainable development, this is very much valuable. We thank you very much, sir. He's the Deputy General Manager of National Water Supply and Drainage Board in storage sector. So all the membership who attended here on behalf of the Building Services Sectional Committee, I thank you very much for your kind attendance. And also we have in our year calendar many more public lectures with similar kind of very important topics, so we invite all of you to attend those. So that will be very much useful for you. Also I want to thank all the administrative staff of ISL for arranging this hall and all the facilities to make this event today. So thank you very much, and hope to see you next time. Have a safe journey. Good night.